33 minutes after the hour. Welcome back to Arkansas Fairways and Greens. Bob Steele, Jay Fox, and Charles Krausen with you this Saturday morning across the Arkansas Radio Network. And joining us on the live line is the Vice President of the International Clubmakers Guild, Mr. Frank Viola. Good morning, Mr. Viola.
Good morning, gentlemen. How is everybody today?
Hey, we are great, and we appreciate so much you joining us. And first, tell our listeners what the International Clubmakers Guild is, because a lot of them may not realize that you exist. I know you've been in business since 2009, and this is a nonprofit, but tell us a little bit about your organization.
Well, it's the very first member-owned organization that's made up of a bunch of clubmakers, starting at hobbyists, even guys who don't really do too much in the business, but like to see what's going on, like to see what's out there for new equipment, building. And also there's a bunch of us that do this full-time and pay our bills by doing it. So we're made up through a wide array of people, and we really enjoy that part of it. It's fun for all ages, as they say.
Frank, I know, as I mentioned, that you were formed 7 years ago. How many countries are represented by the membership of the Guild at this point?
11 or 12 right now.
Wow. Well, what are the services that you offer to your members?
Well, we have a great forum that President had put together, Jacques Intriere. It's a forum where you can go in there, you can ask questions. We have a fantastic resource library where beginners, novices, and the experienced alike can go in there. They can look at videos that show them how to put a club together, show them how to do a certain thing to a golf club or a shaft. Interaction, we have chapter meetings. We just came back from our very successful European chapter meeting that we had held in St. Andrews, and that was an absolute blast.
Wow, I bet it was at the home of golf. Well, I'm going to ask you some more questions about your organization here in just a moment, but I'm curious about you. How did you get involved in making clubs or fitting clubs?
Well, that's a great question, and I love to tell the story. I put my first set of clubs together in 1990. I was in high tech. I got a degree in manufacturing engineering, and like most other people, they have high aspirations of working on their own and doing stuff on their own. So a guy that worked for me actually bought a bunch of components. He bought a set of shafts. He bought some heads. He bought some grips. And he said, "Hey, Frank, I'm going to try to put these together tomorrow. If I need any help, I'm going to call you." So that's where it started back in 1990. He called me on a Saturday morning, went over there, helped put them together. We played golf later that afternoon. And I actually tried them. And I said, "Wow, these feel pretty good. There must be something to this custom-built stuff." Took off, like I said, as a hobby, and the more I did it, the more I liked it, and then decided back in the late 90s that I was going to step into the sunset and start a new career.
Wow. So you got hooked by helping somebody put together a set of clubs.
That's exactly right, yes.
In recent years, we've seen an explosion in the manufacture of golfing equipment, and it has become an incredibly competitive industry. How were you able to become a member and organize a group that shares information and knowledge about designing and making golf clubs? Where did that idea come from?
Well, it has to go back to a group prior to us, which was called the Professional Clubmakers Society, PCS. And that went under, back in the mid to late 90s. I'm not sure the exact date. Things kind of got stale. Things went haywire. And an offshoot of that group realized that just a few years later that there was still some merit to having an organization that was willing to help out those guys who wanted to be part of a public forum, guys who wanted to learn more but couldn't go anywhere to learn, whether it was through classes in Goldsmith and Dallas or locally in Ohio at Golfworks. So this band started up again, and I actually think it started in 2008. That's when the grassroots of the organization was formed. And from 2009, and then the membership just grew. We were very fortunate that we were able to weed out some of the older blood in it. and brought on some real progressive people like one of our former presidents, Eddie Smith, and current president, Jacques Entrier, who deserves 99.9% of the credit for this organization taking off the way it has.
You know, Mr. Viola, my name is Charles Krausen here. I'm with Bob this morning. One of our members on the broadcast team who's in studio with us now, Jay Fox, is the executive director of the Arkansas State Golf Association. Now, he periodically attends learning sessions on the rules for the game of golf. Does the Guild offer certifications for those who make clubs to make sure they conform or other ideas there, that they the rules for club fitters?
Yes, we do. As a matter of fact, we have an extensive and great certification program on written and also on practical. And if guys think that's hard to pass, wait till they get to the point where they want to become qualified for like a club maker of the year, whether it be regional, statewide, international club maker of the year. There's a tremendous amount that goes into that. But we also do have that online body that's there that monitors the like I said, the resource library is fantastic. We've got a bunch of videos in there. A lot of our more experienced members add to that on a daily basis. And you could become a member of that. You could go in and learn everything there is to know and become a certified club maker from, like I say, a practical standpoint, a written standpoint. And we could certainly help you get your business off and running in the right direction.
One of the questions I have for you is, you're called the International Club Makers Guild, and yet your website is clubfittersguild.org. Do you do things besides just fitting clubs? Are there other folks in the organization that maybe aren't club fitters?
Well, yeah, like I said, we do have a group of members, and we don't try to limit it to just guys who build and fit clubs. I mean, there's all kinds of guys that are in there. There's engineers, there's dentists, there's doctors. Like I said, guys who like to keep their finger on the pulse to see what's going on within the club-making world. So, yeah, I mean, you don't have to have any kind of credentials to become a member of our organization, just to, you know, come in, be a member in good standing, and, you know, do your thing, whether it's just reading the online forums, or, like I said, going into the resource library and watching all the instructional videos. I mean, we've got hours upon hours of videos in that resource library, which is very beneficial to all of us.
We have some outstanding club fitters here in Arkansas, and club fitting, I think, has become club making is, I don't know how to put this, one of the major things that happens to a player, I think, usually, of better ability. You go see a guy and get yourself some clubs made. And all of us have used things like a launch monitor that help us fit our swing to a certain kind of clubs. Is this the kind of things that are taught and that you get together and discuss, is how to fit a person to the club and then exactly how to make the club? Do you have seminars on these kinds of things or what?
Yeah, well, we do. Well, first of all, we have our meetings that we have with everybody. We have a webinar series that we have one a month. And say, for instance, like you use the word launch monitor, FlightScope is a sponsor of ours. They'll come on and they'll do a on-screen. We use GoToWebinar, GoToMeeting. It's the same thing. And we have them come on once a month. Like I said, FlightScope was one. Everybody can sit in. Where we're international, what we do is we tape these as well so people can watch these at their leisure. And we'll have a representative from, say, FlightScope come on, talk all about the process. They'll go through their testing, what their seminars are like, what's involved if you wanted to go to one of those. But just to touch base on one thing that you said as far as custom fitting goes, better players do get custom fit, but it's much easier to understand that a better player can make almost anything work to his advantage. The custom fitting really comes in, and I don't want to say so much of a novice, but the guy who has started needs to take his level to the next game, and he's the guy that's going to benefit by custom fitting really more than anyone. I mean, I'm not making a little point of the fact that pros or even better players shouldn't get fitted, but it's just not the better guy that gets fit. Even that guy, like I said, who started, who's got the bug, who's enjoyed everything about the game, now wants to take his game to that very next level. It benefits him to go for a good custom fit and get clubs that fit him.
I think one of the things that troubles those of us who love this game is the fact that after watching it explode during the Tiger era, we're seeing the game declining somewhat. We're seeing fewer young people taking up golf. I would guess that the same thing might be happening in your industry. What are you doing to attract younger club makers, younger fitters into your industry?
Well, that's another great question, and that's a tough thing to do. There aren't many of us in our organization that do this as full-time and pay our bills with it. But, you know, one of the things that we started with these chapter meetings, and again, that was a great idea by Jacques, the president, is he and I went over to the St. Andrews meeting, and we had different sponsors there. We try to encourage people to, you know, look at their different models, their business models. Things have changed a lot since club making first came on board. A lot of the companies now, like Callaway and TaylorMade, Mizuno, Tour Edge Exotics, a lot of these bigger companies are now affording club makers just the heads only so that we can custom build them. Our business is my business model. It's very much the same as Jacques's. We're taking these OEM heads and build these clubs to the next level with shafts that aren't readily available from a lot of the retailers. We are true custom fitters. We're just not somebody that you're going to walk into, whether it be a Goldsmith or Dick's Sporting Goods, and you're going to have this kid fit you that's 16, 17 years old. You go back later and tell him your clubs don't work. Well, he's no longer there. He's selling insurance for his grandfather. So, you know, we try to pass along our business model, our expertise, what we do. And like I said, these chapter meetings are a very big part of that, where we can go to these and help these new people along, get into the business, and at least get them started on the right foot on how to make money.
Well, Mr. Viola, Charlie's got one more question. We'll make it quick, Charlie.
Real quickly, for the amateurs who want to know, how do they get in touch with you guys about getting fitted properly, sir?
Just go to the website, Club Makers Guild or clubfittersguild.org, and just send an email to any one of us, or they can send a mass email.
All right, Frank.
To directors@clubmakersguild.org.
Wonderful. Thank you for joining us this morning. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, Frank Viola.
Bye-bye.
And we're back in just a moment.